Hi, I'm Emily.
And I'm Clark.
We live and travel aboard an antique sailboat named Temptress, currently in the Dominican Republic.
We often talk about what cruising really costs. Today we're going to talk about the cost of food.
And we've teamed up with five other YouTube channels from around the globe to talk about food prices in various countries and food availability in different countries. Because if you're cruising, the one cost that you really can't avoid is food. Stay tuned, today's going to be an awesome video.
Living simply on our own, powered by the sea and sky. Anchor down to be with friends, anchor up to say goodbye. Traveling on the winds of change. Adventure.
This is going to be a great video today. We've been working on it for a couple months, getting all the details together. A lot of you are probably new to our channel, and if you are, welcome.
On our channel, we talk about all kinds of different things. But, you know, in a nutshell, it's preparing. It could be preparing financially, where do you invest, all the way to how to fix your outboard motor. We are very open with our finances, and every month we report every cent we spend, so you can get an idea that if you live at our level, how much it would cost, or modify that for your level. We hope you spend some time on our channel and look around, and if you like what you see, please subscribe. We'd appreciate that.
So we just came from the United States last year, where food is plentiful and available and there's such variety. Then we went to the Bahamas, where there's a decent amount of food depending on what island you're on, but it is quite a bit more expensive than the United States, probably 50% or 100% more expensive depending on the product. Now we're here in the Dominican Republic, where everything is so inexpensive. We just did a huge stock-up trip, and we thought we would have spent $600, $700 when we looked at the bill and converted it to dollars. It was like $250, and that's like a semi-annual shopping trip for us. So those were some big extremes, and that's what inspired us to say, I wonder what it looks like right now in other parts of the world. So that's where this video came from. Some of these are big channels that you probably already recognize. Other ones are smaller channels, but all of them have their own unique flavor of how to handle the question of buying food and living on a boat. Some of them are in the Mediterranean, some of them in the Caribbean, and other places as well.
After you've watched this video, I suggest you take a look in the description. You'll find a playlist there. It has videos from all of the contributors, longer form, and it'll give you a good flavor for what their channels are like. You might find a new favorite.
Lastly, if you like this collaborative style of video, please give us a like and subscribe for more content like this.
Without further ado, let's introduce you to our friends.
First up, let's take a quick sail across the Caribbean and check in with our friends in St. Martin. Hey guys!
Good day!
Hey guys, thanks so much for involving us in this collaboration.
Thanks so much for being here. Tell us a little bit about who you are and your boat and where you're at.
I'm Simon, this is my wife Kim, and we're sailing Britican. We've been living on the boat now for 7 years, and we've been traveling around. Also, we have a daughter, Sienna, who's now 10.
And Britican stands for British and American, and our daughter is a true Britican.
She is. And we are now here in St. Martin on the Dutch side, but we've spent hurricane season in Grenada.
Yeah, we just came up like last week.
Yeah, we did.
So quite interesting. We've been in Grenada for 2 years now.
Yeah, off and on.
And through COVID and stuff, so it's nice to be someplace different.
Please tell us a little bit about food shopping in St. Martin.
So we're here in St. Martin. The fantastic thing about St. Martin is the grocery stores are like they are back in the US or in Europe, and you can get anything you want. There's even like a Sam's Club and a Costco's here with a bulk store. It's just absolutely fantastic.
And the great thing about St. Martin is it's split into two different countries. You've got the Dutch side, which we're in right now, and then you've got the French side, which is like I can see. So you have amazing French foods, you've got Dutch foods, you've got European foods, but there's a massive influence here of Americans, so you've got all of the American foods too. So this really is a food mecca here.
Coming from Grenada, there's only one modernish supermarket, but here it's just like food heaven.
Yeah, in Grenada, like, we could go maybe a week or two without seeing a tomato. There was 1 month we went without seeing lettuce. And sometimes there's stuff there, like you would go into the store and there'd be like a huge bin of eggplant, and then next week, you know, you'd come in with your recipe for eggplant and there'd be no eggplant and you'd never see them again. So a big difference coming up here to St. Martin, where it seems like you can get not only one type of tomato, but you can get 8 different varieties.
We were here about 18 months ago, but we did find problems getting fresh milk. But we went out 2 days ago and we found loads of it. So maybe they've...
Maybe the Americans or somebody's complained and now St. Martin has fresh milk.
Or they found lots of cows somewhere.
Yeah. Maybe, but the cool thing is here, I mean, we haven't found anything that we can't find yet.
Wow, that's great to have so much food available. Can you tell us a little bit about your budget and what you guys spend?
To feed the three of us, we generally, when we go out shopping, it's about $200, $250. But we don't go out every week to the grocery store.
Yeah, and because we know the Caribbean so well, we know exactly where to go and what to get. So all the French islands, including St. Martin, Guadeloupe, Martinique, they all have absolutely fantastic stores and the prices are really good. And that's for meat and cheese and some of the stuff that you can't get at the other countries. And also, definitely for wine and beer, we might spend a couple thousand dollars when we go to the French islands, but we fill every nook and cranny of the boat and it will last us for months.
We've got wine freak.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I can identify with that. I love those French grocery stores. Last time I was out there, I took on 100 bottles of Bordeaux, and I just treasured them for years.
Thank you guys so much for taking the time to share your food budget and your food experience with us today.
It's been great to be involved.
Yeah, and before we say goodbye, just a quick note on a food-themed video that we've created over on our Sailing Britican channel. We created a video that offers 3 tips to making provisioning and cooking easy on a boat. So head over there when you get a chance and check that out.
Yeah, Kim, we've got a great video up there with some provisioning tips about how to provision, how to meal plan, and how to prepare meals in advance for your family. So we'll put a link to that in the description where people can find it. Thanks so much, you guys. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Now let's go across the Atlantic to Portugal and talk to our friends on Sailing Ocean Fox.
Hi, Clark.
Hi, Emily.
Great to see you again.
Great to see you guys again, too. Would you guys tell us a little bit about yourselves and your boat and tell us what food is like in Portugal?
I'm Carla.
I'm Simon, and we live on our Lagoon 400, which is a 40-foot catamaran. And we recently got back from the Caribbean and we are currently in the Algarve in Portugal.
And our YouTube channel is Sailing Ocean Fox. We have a wide variety of stores here in Portugal. Everything from huge hypermarkets to the local fruit and vegetables markets, street markets.
Yeah. In fact, we're completely spoiled. We've got everything from the upmarket supermarkets like Waitrose, right the way down to the German discount stores. And even then, there's lots of corner shops, and even the marinas have little stores on them that sell everything from bread to camping gas.
You can find everything you want here on the shops in Portugal. So everything from, Portuguese specialities, like cheese, bread, cured meats, and codfish, and things like that.
Yeah, in addition to that, all the stores have sort of international aisles, and there's even international supermarkets and British supermarkets because there's a huge British community here in the south of Portugal. One of the things we do doing more recently is we've been going shellfishing. So we go out onto the sandbanks at low tide, and in the shallow water you find little holes in the sand and you pour in some salt. And the next thing is the razor clam shoots up.
Yeah, and then you crab it.
Yep. Yeah. Put it in the bucket and you get around about 20 to 25, don't you?
Yeah, it depends how long you stay there.
Yes, how long you stay there. But then you actually take it back to the boat.
Yeah, and then you're leaving in salt water for about an hour, so the sand comes off and they're still alive. And then you cook with, tomato, onions, sauce and garlic. So it's very, very typical food here. And it's delicious, isn't it?
It is. And it's a good way of supplementing the budget, isn't it?
So you guys just got back from the Caribbean. How do food prices compare between the Caribbean islands and Portugal?
we've been back in Europe for only 2 months. We crossed from the Bahamas via Bermuda and the Azores. And to be perfectly honest, we absolutely can't believe the cost of food here. It is so much cheaper than the Caribbean, and I'd say we're probably spending around about 30% of what we were spending on the other side of the pond.
Can you give us a few examples of the prices?
Yeah, for example, if you get a pint of milk here, it will cost you 53 cents. If you get 300 grams of cheese, it will cost you around €3. What else? A bottle of wine will cost you around €2.
Yeah. And that would be costing 25 in Bermuda.
Yeah. So things are really, really cheap here. We tend to shop for fruits and vegetables in local street markets, so in that way we help the locals and we get cheaper products. For example, we went last Sunday, we went to the shop in Alvo, the market in Alvo, and for the whole lot of vegetables we spent €10.20, which is really, really cheap.
Those sound like really great prices. Can you tell us a little more about your whole overall budget?
I would guess now we'll be spending less than €100 a week on food and wine.
That includes alcohol.
And that includes the alcohol, yeah, the beer as well. And we only eat out about twice a week.
Yes.
Yeah. So
all the other meals are on the boat. Yeah.
And you two have put up a great video comparing the prices between the Caribbean and Europe, along with some of Carla's recipes and storage tips. So we'll put some of that in the description so people can find that too.
Thanks, Carla. Thanks, Simon.
Thank you very much for having us on this collaboration. It was really fun.
Yeah, great to see you again, guys. Bye.
Thanks so much. It was great to see you too as well. Bye-bye.
Bye. Let's come back across the Atlantic and see what it's like to buy food on a budget in Caribbean Mexico. Robbie and Justine on Sailorama have something for us.
What? Hello, Emily and Clark.
Hi, I'm Robinson, and this is Justine, my wife.
We're here aboard our boat in Esperado on the Riviera Maya.
In Quintana Roo, Mexico. This is what provisioning in Mexico looks like.
Sounds great. Tell us what it's like to go shopping in Mexico.
So our new normal for provisioning here is to wash our hands and to put on our masks before entering any shops. Then it's a 10-minute bicycle up the hill to the small town. The two largest supermercados here are called Chedraui and Super Aki. First stop, fruits and veggies. Like anywhere, we buy the tastiest fruits at the best prices when they are in season. The greens have just been stocked today. They look great. So for the next 4 or 5 days, we're going to be eating really healthy meals. About 7 pesos means less than or around 50 cents for bunches of spinach, other leafy greens, spring onions,
main staple in Mexico, green onions,
and 75 cents for bunches of basil, mint, and other herbs. Dried herbs and spices are not the cheapest here, but we are thankful for their abundance and selection that can flavor many styles of cooking. At $1.50 a kilo, I don't think it's a great steal, but it's nice to get some fresh pineapple that came from just the next state over. Not much is grown in the porous rock landscape of the Yucatan Peninsula. So the same goes for avocados. About $1 a kilo, not mind-blowingly cheap, but they're abundant and they're fresh. We eat fresh tomatoes in almost every one of our meals, and we use limes every day as well. We spend a total of about $15 to $20 US on fresh produce each week, and we definitely lean more towards root vegetables when we don't have access to a fridge. Eggs are not refrigerated here, which is also great for us. $3 for free-range organic or $1 for a dozen of lower quality eggs. If you watch our videos, you'll know that the majority of our protein is caught by the fishing nut Robbie. I don't eat other meat than that, but sometimes we'll buy some chicken for the dog or for Robbie at around $2 per kilo. There is no lack of chili sauces anywhere you go in Mexico, but for the red sauces that are tomato-based, for pasta meals, we find the prices are less than ideal. That is why we make our sugos from scratch. And for $2.50, a large can of crushed tomatoes is a great long-term storage item. Varying quality tequilas line most store shelves, but the sailor's essential drink, rum, is also available for around $7 a liter. Spanish and Italian wines are very popular here, and I can't seem to bring myself to buy these $8 Californian wines that I have seen for half the price in the States. Delicious local cheeses can be found outside the supermercado for about $5 or $6 a kilo, but a favorite of ours is the $2 grocery store goat cheese. We usually buy powdered milk, which is widely available throughout Mexico, but the 1 liter bottles of fresh milk will set you back about $1.50 to $2. The fruit juices like orange juice. With an ingredient list that starts off with sugar rather than actual oranges, we tend to buy the fresh fruit and just squeeze it ourselves. Fresh bread is easy to come by, but the true Mexican specialty, of course, is the corn or wheat tortillas. Expect to find tortillas on every corner, at every shop, and for less than a dollar a kilo. We buy our drinking water weekly using large trade-in gallon bottles, but some other people tend to just buy beer. Just over 2 liters, a six-pack of beer will set you back about $2.50 or $3.50, depending on the design on the front of the can. Be very careful with the sugary drinks in this hot environment. They are easy to gulp down, and almost the same price as bottled water in some cases. I hope this gives you an idea of what provisioning here is like in this part of the world.
It sure does. And I miss those Valencia oranges in Mexico. They make such wonderful juice. Thanks for sharing, guys.
See you later.
See you later.
And Justine and Robbie have put up a great video about fishing and foraging on a boat. So if you're especially interested in a low-budget option, you may want to check out that video as well.
Back across the Atlantic now. Let's go up into the Med and see what Sailing Fair Isle has for us.
Hi guys, I'm Judy.
And I'm Steve, and this is Fair Isle. She's a Hans Christian 48T, and we've been living aboard for, 4 years now?
4 years, and for the past 2 years we've been in the Med, which is a pretty good place for food. You can get anything you want, really. Lots of vegetables. I eat a lot of vegetables, I'm a vegetarian. And last time I went shopping in Venice, I bought vegetables from a barge in the middle of a canal. So that's different.
Yep, that's where we are now in Venice. And everything's done on the water. I mean, they do have supermarkets here. They didn't if you went back sort of 10 or 15 years ago. It's sort of a fairly new thing. But pretty much all over the Med, you can get to a supermarket and the prices are pretty similar.
We spend most of our time anchored out. So for us, it's getting to the food, wherever it is, by dinghy. When we were in the Mar Menor during lockdown, that was a bit of an issue because it was a good 20-minute dinghy ride and then another 20-minute, half-an-hour walk to the one shop we were allowed to go to, one at a time.
Yeah, you only allow one person out in Spain during lockdown. But at any time, it's an issue. You know, you don't think about when you're living on a boat, you've got to get that food and, you know, it's bulky, especially if you're getting water. We don't. We have filtered water on here and we just use the water you get from the hose. But it's bulky. So it's bringing that back is always an issue. We try and have bags that have long straps so you can put some on your shoulders. We've got bikes. So if we're somewhere where we can use our bikes, we put them on the handlebars. And here, because everything's done by water, we can just go on the dinghy off the back of the boat, down the canals, fill up and come back, so that's quite good.
Tell us a little more about your budget.
In terms of cost, it's very varied because, Spain was quite cheap. Venice is varied, isn't it? Depends on the shop, frankly.
Look, it's sort of, I think the supermarkets are fairly similar, no matter where you go. But if you go to a tourist area, the little shops are going to be expensive, so you don't have to look far normally to go beyond that. And obviously eating out, exactly the same deal. So we've had places like in sort of little places in Portugal, say, where we can eat out for 10 euros, which is about $7, and that's just by going there and having tapas. You get your little drink, cherry if it's in Portugal probably, and some food just comes for free with it always. And it's the law actually in Catalan and some parts of of Portugal, great law to have, that you have to have food with a drink. So you basically go there, have a few drinks, and you're full. You don't need dinner. But then other places, you can spend 50, 100 euros on a meal. So that's, sort of $70, $80.
You wouldn't believe it looking at those pictures, but we don't eat out very often, actually.
Yeah, that's probably the entirety of all the meals we've ever had, the ones you've just seen there. But actually, I mean, why would you want to eat out? Because, there's usually the nicest place to sit is here in your cockpit with a fantastic view at anchor somewhere.
Just as the sun goes down. So I as expect you agree. Everyone agrees.
Plastic one.
Okay.
Plastic bottle, that was all of €1.59.
Excellent.
Bottle.
Yep.
And this is our usual, really expensive, almost €5, €4.40.
Okay.
No, I don't get the
Okay, I've got some water though. Well, they're just very different, aren't they? This is fruitier. I think I prefer this one.
You prefer that one?
Yeah.
Good. That's that one.
Really?
Yeah.
Excellent.
But, I actually prefer this one.
But then
maybe it's psychological, because I knew this was the expensive, but this was
okay.
Three times the price of that one.
Well, there you go then. I have no taste. Oh, I have cheap taste. Just as well.
Cheap taste.
We're really cheap on wine, too. Don't worry, Judy. We've got really frugal taste in wine as well. Thank you guys so much for sharing with us today. We really appreciate it.
Thanks, Emily and Clark. See you soon.
Thanks a lot.
That's a really great tip about the bags. And that's a great tip in general. People go out sailing and they don't realize you're going to be using your feet to get your groceries. We use a soft frame backpack and it makes life a lot easier.
Mm-hmm. Great tip. And they've got some other great tips in another video that they've posted. You can see all the signature European dishes that they tried on their way around Europe and into the Med. And you can also see what happened when they ran out of propane during lockdown in Spain during COVID and how they dealt with that in some creative ways.
That was a challenge.
Well, we've got one more couple to talk to today, and it's probably a couple that a lot of you have already heard of. We're going to go down through the Panama Canal and talk to our friends who have been doing this for many years.
Hi, Paul and Cheryl. It's been a while.
Hey, guys.
Hey, guys.
So great to connect this way. Thanks very much for inviting us to be part of this video. We're Cheryl and Paul Sharp, Sailboat Distant Shores 3. We have been the hosts of the Distant Shores Sailing Adventure Travel TV series, which is in its 12th season on AWE TV in the US and territories and 24 other languages around the world.
Cheryl and I have been cruising and living aboard for 30 years now, so we've got lots of experience to share.
You absolutely do. Could you tell us about where you are now?
We're at La Playeta Marina in Panama, right near Panama City on the Pacific coast of Panama.
We just got back to the boat a couple of weeks ago after being locked out of the boat when we were stuck up in Canada. We couldn't get back to her for 7.5 months.
We had just come through the Panama Canal at the end of February and we were getting ready for our first cruise of the South Pacific when everything locked down. So we've been home in Canada ever since.
We sailed to Panama from the Bahamas. We did a 7-day crossing, going south between Haiti and Cuba, and then straight across the Caribbean Sea to get to Panama and the canal.
Yeah, and in fact, it was in the Bahamas that we met you and Clark,
that's right.
Emily.
Yeah, it was great to meet you guys in Georgetown. We really love the Bahamas.
Now that you're back on the boat, what is it like to get her food stores back in order?
After being away from the boat for so long, we had to clear out a lot of stuff. There was expired things and a few things that gone off in the 7 months. But Panama is really a great place to reprovision. There are all kinds of large American-style grocery stores here, and the public transportation is great. There's buses, taxis, Ubers. And
we've never actually done a bus.
No.
And now less people are using them, so the Ubers and taxis are all over
right.
the place.
Right, yeah, and masks are required to be worn everywhere, but everyone here is very careful. So I had a lot of different stores to choose from, and because of the shipping here, I mean, it's such a hub, you can get just about everything. And the prices are pretty similar to what we found at home and in the U.S. And the currency is the U.S. dollar, so that makes things really easy. There's a few things that might be more expensive, but generally it's very easy as far as getting cash, getting a ride there, and having a choice. Okay, back on board. We've got a week's worth of groceries, plus we've topped up a little bit on things that we were, you know, needing to restock for $247. I feel like that's a pretty good thing. We bought alcohol and milk and quite a few imported goods. The imported goods are slightly more expensive, but really in general, it's about what I would expect to pay at home. The beauty is that you can get everything, you know, products from all over the world, and it's just such a great place to stock up. This is probably a little more than we'd spend on an average week because we've been away and we've been restocking, but we also have a lot of supplies on board, you know, canned and dried goods that are fine and some really nice bottles of wine that we've been saving. So it's a balance. We a little bit more on some things and not, you know, we don't have to spend a lot because we are still pretty stocked up. Panama is a great place to provision if you're heading either direction. It's a great place to stock up.
Well, we wish you both the best of luck restocking the boat in Panama. Hope you enjoy it down there, and we look forward to seeing you again someday soon.
That was all really interesting to see. a lot of these places I've been to, and it was interesting for me to see how they've changed. Grocery stores have gotten bigger, selection's gotten better, and, you know, life marches on.
Yeah, it's interesting to see a place that has a Costco. Let's go there.
Yeah.
So this video is getting a little long, so instead of going through our budget in the Dominican Republic, we're going to direct you to one of our adventure logs. Every month we sit down and we talk about dollar for dollar what we spent. We always do it for less than $1,000 a month if we can. So tune into that adventure log linked in the description and subscribe to our channel, and you can see that every month and see more content like this.
As a final part of this video, we want to compare specific items and what they cost in different places. And Emily's been busily working on her laptop, getting all the data together and making some really cool graphs.
And not only do we have the information for the five countries and the five channels that participated today, we've got our information from the Dominican Republic, our earlier information from the Bahamas, and Kim in St. Martin has also sent us their recent grocery list from St. Lucia. So we've got eight different countries, and you can see what these different things cost. Here it is.
This was a really interesting project for us. If you're a sailing channel or you know of a sailing channel that might be interested in a further extension of this project, send us a message. Either put it down below or, you know, all the social media things that everybody's hooked up on. We'll get another group of people together that are interested and we'll do another one.
Yeah, I think that would be really fun. We can keep it going. We always on our channel really like things not just to be about us, but to be about the sailing community and to be about potential sailors and cruisers who are looking for information about things like food and expenses. Maybe there's something else that you want to compare prices with across the globe. Let us know in the comments. Hit a like if you really enjoyed this video, and please, please check out these other great and worthy sailing channels who are sharing information with viewers like you for free here on YouTube. Support us all and keep us all going. Much love from us. We'll talk to you next time.
Bye.
When we met, we knew that we did things differently, but with no regrets, both living life authentically. So we packed up this antique boat to make a life upon the sea. Adventure.